Loud. Yes, this is now recording. Don't say fuck or bugger. Oh, sorry. So here we go. So if you are, so in this piece, we're going to have Jill, Keeley, Al, Moses, Alina, and I'll be reading stage directions. So please, if you are not those people, let me just do.
James gone off frame.
Sorry?
I think James has gone out of frame.
He's gone out of frame?
On account of the fact that he...
Oh, right, I see what you mean, yes.
Dan,
before I
mute myself, Meredith asked, could you put the Zoom ID and password in? Because is the link's not letting her on for some reason.
Okay, could you text her the meeting ID is 863...
863...
1347...
347...
0238.
Yep.
Okay, I'm just want to turn off. Okay, that's better. Good. All right, I'm going to turn off my video because I'm just going to be doing stage directions. Okay, so. Here we are with How We Fall Under Collapsing Kaleidoscopes. Scene 4. A room with a bed. The exhibitionist sits on the bed. The warm bodies queue up to one side. Each one is holding a plastic wrapped bunch of flowers, much like you find in a petrol station. They sometimes exchange them with one another. The exhibitionist's partner sits in the corner of the room silently. The exhibitionist...
It was my other half's idea, initially. He wanted to branch out and experiment. I said, if you can branch out, then I can too. Together. This was the middle ground. It's weird, though. Nobody seems to call it swinging, or a sex party, or an orgy, the blatantly obvious. Just the group. No idea why.
One of the warm bodies approaches the exhibitionist and hands them their bunch of flowers.
James, 32, logistics.
The exhibitionist hands him back one of the flowers from the bunch and places them on the bed. The warm body moves.
Nice to look at, that one. Cute face. Obviously looks after himself. Girthy. Could have sworn he was doing times tables towards the end of that, though. I'm not out loud, but you can tell. Behind the eyes. I'd give that 6 out of 10. A nice appetizer.
Another warm body, another exchange of flowers.
Thomas, 46, HR.
A flower is given to the warm body from the previous warm body's bunch. The warm body moves on.
A bit older than my usual. Very gentle, though. He must be a regular. Experienced. Light 7, strong 6. I think I recognise him from one of the other parties. He has a level of calm about him. I think I'll be like that one day.
A warm body, a bunch of flowers.
Gillian, 28, site manager.
The exhibitionist makes a real show of handing her 3 flowers to the other warmed bodies.
The fairer sex. She was cute. Pretty, I guess. Hard body. We made a real show of it. We have to. At least 3 gentlemen are rubbing one out as we speak. A light 8 out of 10, just for that. Nothing really beats it. Being wanted like that. Nothing at all.
The exhibitionist looks to their partner. They do not make eye contact.
I need more.
2 warm bodies approach with flowers in hand.
Scott, student, 20. Daryl, student, 19.
The exhibitionist hands them back an entire bunch to share.
Oh, a nervous pair. What looked like the younger one had a hard time keeping it up. I think I switched off, though. My brain disconnected again. Blank, but not. I know I'm here, but I'm not. Oh, I sound stupid. I always do when I talk like this. A four, I guess.
They look over to their partner, who was receiving a bunch of flowers from another warm body.
Look.
The flower ritual continues. Each warm body presents their bunch of flowers and is given one in return.
Adrian, 32, plumber.
Short. Had a lot of anger to get out. 7.
Tim, 25, personal trainer.
Oh, talk. 4. Next.
Kathleen, 30, admin.
Oh, someone who can actually find a clitoris. Thank God. An 8. I need more.
Jeff, 40, doorman.
7. More.
Frank, 33, unemployed.
6. Next.
Jane, 39, housewife.
Callum, 27.
Oh, more.
Gareth, 34.
More.
Millie.
Oh, more.
Jonathan.
Another.
Carol. Hold on, sorry.
Why?
James.
Won't.
Gareth.
He.
Scott.
Look.
Gillian.
The exhibitionist is surrounded by plastic wrapped bunches of flowers. They outline her frame as if she's in some kind of cellophane wrapped May Queen. The exhibitionist's partner remains silent and still.
Look at me. Look at me. Want me. Need me. Just me. This is for you. All for you. Please. Why won't you look?
Blackout. Scene 5, first time caller. An email exchange. A DSLR camera is set facing a bed. Performer and consumer start either side of the stage.
Hi there, Rasmus, big underscore daddy 1999. First off, I want to say a huge thank you for subscribing to become a Platinum tier patron on my site. As part of your tier, you will be receiving the following. Daily naughty photos, early access to all new professional photo shoots, signed poster sets and merch sent monthly, VIP for meet and greets at any of my con dates, and weekly personalised chat, exclusive to Platinum patrons. We can catch up, hang out and get to know each other. Looking forward to hearing from my most amazing subscribers. Talk soon. Yours, Aero Madam, Katie.
Hi Katie. Is it okay to call you that, Bob? Just wanted to say congrats on becoming partnered in your streaming venture. I can see big things ahead of you. Your You Lose, You Strip streams are amazing. It's so rare to see someone actually good at the game. I bet all those little nerds are so upset you don't actually lose that often, lol. The new photo set was so sexy, by the way. Beautiful. You should be professionally modelling, honestly. I don't understand why you haven't broken out yet into magazines or anything. That may just be me being fanboy, though, so I might be a tiny bit biased. What games have you been playing recently? I saw on your stream that you've been censoring some of them so randoms don't join your matches, but they're still showing up on your private gaming account. Just a heads up. Not sure what else to say, really. Hope to hear from you soon and keep the daily photos coming. Yum.
Hi, Rasmus. Sure, you can call me Katie. Most of my Platinum patrons do. Thank you for all the compliments. The You Lose series has been a real hit with my streamers. I think most people forget I'm actually part of an esports team, so I'm always trying to play to a high level. If you'd like to see some more professional modelling that I've done a few shoots with some agencies that I can link below if you'd like to show some support. It means a lot. Can I also just ask how you got access to my private gaming account? It's only for friends and other streamers. It's not a big deal, I'd just like to know. Yours, Aero Madam.
Katie, I am so sorry about the gaming account. One of my friends, who is one of the people you sometimes stream with, gave me a link to join. I didn't know it was a big deal or not. They'd said it wasn't, but I've unfollowed and I promise I won't join again. I'm so sorry if I've made you feel uncomfortable in any way. I hope you're doing okay. I loved your latest photo set. Can't wait for the next one. Rasmus.
Hey, Rasmus. Honestly, it's no big deal. Thank you for unfollowing from the group. I really appreciate it. You wouldn't believe the amount of people I have joining who refuse to leave and keep on trying to get involved in all my games and harassing me. If you could see my block list, you wouldn't believe your eyes. Just to let your friend know not to give out my information anymore. I think I know who it is, but I don't really think they're worth getting upset about. Also, just a heads up, there is a new set coming out that is part of the series with a bunch of other streamers that's going to be published in some big magazines. I thought you might be interested because you asked about my professional modeling career. Not many people ask about it, so if you could spread the word, that would be amazing. Yours, Aero Madam.
Hi, Katie. Oh my gosh, lol. I can imagine you have so many creepy little cucks perving on you. The stream chats are bad enough, but at least they have mods to keep it on track. Most guys these days are just disgusting. They have no idea how to talk to a woman of your caliber. No idea how to respect women. Don't worry about me, though. I'm always on my best behaviour. Lol. I've got to say, though, your most recent private snaps you've been putting out for us Platinum tiers have been testing my gentleman's resolve, if you know what I mean. But I'll stay strong for you. Don't want you to think I'm like some of your more vulgar fans. Can't wait to hear from you. Rasmus. Hiya, Katie. I didn't hear from you this week. Is everything okay? You haven't been updating your private snap, and I know some of your photos didn't ship out this week either. A lot of the other Platinum and Gold tiers have been kicking off. Some were even asking for a refund after a week. But I've been keeping control of them as best I can. Always here if you need to talk. Rasmus.
Hi, Rasmus. I'm sorry I missed my tier rewards last week. I've had a recent bereavement in the family, so I took some time out to look after my mental health. I should have said something sooner to all you amazing patrons, but I let you down. I'll be working twice as hard to give you all the content you've been waiting for and beyond. Thank you for being so understanding. It's been a rough week or two. Yours, Aero Madam.
I'm so glad to hear from you. I was starting to get really worried. It's really hard to lose a loved one, so I totally understand and respect your decision to look after yourself. Mental health is super important. Screw those guys who unsubscribed. They want to take a woman's livelihood over something like this, and they don't deserve you. Like I said before, I'm always here if you need me. I'm sending over something to your site donations page that might help you out after the loss of subscribers. Yours, Rasmus.
Rasmus! Oh my god, thank you so, so much. You don't understand how much this has helped me out. I was scared about paying rent this month, and this is my only income, and now I don't have to worry anymore. This means so, so much to me, and I really can't thank you enough. Let me know if you want anything extra from the site. I can do a thank you package with all the merch I do, etc. I know it isn't much, but right now it's the best I can do. Again, Rasmus, thank you from the bottom of my heart. Yours, Katie.
Hi, Katie. It's no worry at all. Anything to help out my favourite lady. Just got the care package through, and I have to say it's some of your best work yet. I could look at these for hours on end. In fact, I have, lol. Just kidding. The merch is so well made too. Fits perfectly, and I love wearing it out and about. Feels good to show my support out in public with my family and friends. Did you spray them with perfume too? What kind is it? I can send you some more if you like. Yours always, Rasmus.
Hi, Rasmus. I'm glad you enjoyed it. I made sure to put some special effort in for all the help that you've given me. I'm looking forward to getting back to my regular streaming schedule this week, and I'm going to be putting out some of my best content yet. I think all of you guys are going to really enjoy it. Yours, Aero Madam.
Consumer picks up an envelope before walking off stage and then returning. Performer, hearing the door go, goes off stage and comes back with the envelope. She opens it, reads it, then places it on the bed.
Hi, Katie. I saw your newest stream, and you were right. They have been amazing. Everyone in the forum is raving about them. Oh, perfection. The new icons for the chat and the multi-camera shots are genius. I'm so proud of how you picked yourself back up. I'm glad I could be part of your newfound determination. I sent you a little surprise to say well done. I hope you liked it. Your Rasmus.
Hello, Rasmus. Firstly, I want to say that I'm very appreciative of everything you've done for me. It really does mean the world to me, and I mean that wholeheartedly. Whilst I appreciate the gesture, I'm not sure I'm entirely comfortable with you knowing my home address, and even more so, sending dinner reservations to me. It's very sweet that you do something like that for me, but I keep a very clear line between my professional life and my private life. Again, thank you for everything that you've done for me, but please don't send anything more to my home address. Error, madam.
Hi, Katie. I'm sorry again for making you feel uncomfortable. It's obviously something I keep doing, so I will try to be better. I just thought we'd gotten close, you know? Properly. Guess I was wrong. I helped you out in your personal life and then you shut me out. Thanks. You're Rasmus.
Rasmus, as I've said time and time again, I'm so grateful for the help you have given me. I would hate to think that you thought I wasn't appreciative, but my home is my home, and I like to keep it away from what I do for work. I saw that you'd bought me the new cosplay set I did on the early bird package. How do you like it? I try to go a little lewder than usual for all my amazing supporters, like you. Yours, Arrow Madam.
Katie, I did purchase your newest set before you'd sent me your original message about your personal life. In hindsight, I'm not sure I should have. I've been nothing but a gentleman to you these past few weeks. I drove for £600 in one donation and reserved seats in a restaurant way above where you normally eat. Not only that, but I also made sure to pick somewhere you could get to by bus or by foot because I know that you don't drive. I'm hurt, Katie. I really am. Rasmus.
Consumer walks off stage.
How do you know that I don't drive? Or the bus routes where I live?
Pause. Performer hears the door go again and goes off stage. She returns with dozens of envelopes.
Rasmus, are you sending me these? It's not funny.
Consumer returns.
Rasmus, if this carries on, I'm going to have to get the police involved. You're really upsetting me.
I'm upsetting you? Please. I sent across an entire month's wages to you, and what do I get? I really appreciate you. No, you don't. Fuck you. If you appreciated me, you'd have gone to dinner with me like I asked. But you're too good for a fan, aren't you? But if success, and this is how you treat me, it's disgusting.
I don't understand. I didn't ask for any of it, Rasmus. You gave me these things off your own back. I can send you back the money if it's that big of a deal. The reservations, though, were too far. You sent them unsolicited to my home, without a stamp, I might add, just with my name on the front, which means you must have delivered them personally or had something else do it for you. How did you even find out where I live? I asked around the gaming account too, and no one there even knows who you are. Did you hack into my gaming account? What else is there I don't know about, Rasmus?
Fuck you.
No, fuck you, Rasmus. I've contacted the police and banned you from all my pages and accounts. Maybe next time don't send me shit with a return to sender address on the back. I bet you put it there in case I wanted to pop over and thank you in person. Goodbye. Do not contact me again.
You stupid fucking bitch. As if you'd actually go and contact the police. You'd like it. You know you do, spending all day posting pictures of your tits and pussy, and only to act surprised when someone takes an interest. You stupid fucking cocktease. You fucking cocktease. You should be fucking flattered that I even put so much time and effort into you. Your content is mid-tier at best, in a sea of other girls willing to fuck themselves on camera. But I take the time. I listen to you when you're sad and whining on about how you've had a death in the family. Everyone loses family. Get over it. It happens. Lol, you lost so many followers that week too. You deserve it too. You deserve anything. I hope you get fucking raped, you stupid cunt. I really hope you die. I was a gentleman and you treated me like dirt. Remember, I know where you live. Maybe I'll do it. Maybe I'll get someone else to do it. And you won't even know. You'll be looking over your shoulder for the rest of your life. If only you'd just taken me up on dinner. I've moved on though. Nice knowing you. See you soon.
Performer takes out her phone and walks off stage. A knock is heard at consumer's door. He opens it and police lights can be seen coming in.
Shit.
Blackout. Round of applause! Very good. Well, well done, guys. Well done, Callum. Very good. Okay. So, next up, we have a little bit of James. So, we're having... I forgot what it's called, James. Why can't I find the script? Sorry about this. We are having...
Ferocious 5.
The ferocious, rather questionable 5.
The ferocious 5, yeah. Something very strange has happened to my other computer, just a sec. So in this one, we should be having Katie, Meredith, Sam, Ryan, Moses, Dan, Alina, and Amy. Very exciting. Just give me 2 secs. I'm double screening and I'm now regretting it suddenly. Okay, let me pull this one up. Good. As with every new writing night, we always have a very eclectic mix of writing, which is great. So let me just get this one. Okay, here we go. Okay, so we're going to crack on with this one. So if you aren't the people that I mentioned, which was a lot of people, please make sure you are muted or you hide your camera because we are recording. And we'll crack on with a little bit of, how could I forget the title? Ferocious and Rather Questionable 5 by James Bryan. Scene 1, Gary. We hear a projector turn on. The whirring of a videotape playing is heard. I'm going to hide my camera. There's the sound of 2 people sitting down. A man grunts and sighs as he sits. The screen is nothing but darkness.
Ready?
Uh-huh. The words Gary strike across the screen. They're in a strong, bold font. The camera pans through them and slowly fades into a back alley. There are police sirens in the distance, smoke rolling off the walls from nearby vents. A boy, hooded, is approaching a stranger who keeps looking around frantically. They shake hands. The voices of Harold and Amelia speak over the scene as it plays. After shaking hands, the hooded boy walks on.
Gary Simmons, age 19. Abusive father. Date from mother is unknown.
Kills?
41.
Identity?
Hidden better than a nun's minge. Police don't even know he exists. He's like some weird modern Robin Hood, only minus the whole living in a forest get-up.
Power?
The hooded boy pulls out a Nerf gun and shoots the stranger with ease. The foam bullet bounces off them and the body falls to the floor.
Can inflict a lot of damage with Nerf guns.
Nerf guns?
Yeah, I told you this was going to be an odd session.
Nerf guns?
Yes, Amelia, Nerf guns. Small, concealable, highly deadly in his hands. Been watching him for a while, the amount of playground massacres I've had to cover up is unbiblical.
But Harold, is a boy running around playing soldiers going to be fit for the task we're proposing?
Watch.
As they have been talking, the boy has been looting the body, fishing out bags of white powder. As they've finished talking, a couple of figures turn the corner in the background of the shot. They spot the boy and start shooting at him, charging forward with urgency. The boy pulls out the Nerf gun and shoots. 2 shots, 2 bodies.
Jesus!
Still not fit enough for the job?
Who's next?
We hear Harold press some sort of button and the name Jesse clicks up onto the screen. Like Gary, but with a different font. More bubbly and soft. The camera pans through the words. Fade in. Scene 2, Jesse. We are now outside. There's a girl sat on a bench, reading and alone. No one is around. It is late at night.
Jesse de Montfort, 21, rich. Family on a 7-bedroom mansion, Waltham residence. 2 pools, 18 corgis, all named after flowers they might find in their 72-acre front lawn. She basically screams old money. Avid book reader. She could quote the Argonautica word for word while giving birth to a giant. Power. Every time she coughs, she teleports. Most of the time.
As she is reading, she coughs and suddenly vanishes from the screen.
Involuntarily, and every time.
The camera spins round to show a river. Jessie is sat miserably in it. Her book is soaked.
To a destination she did not desire.
Fuck! She doesn't know when she teleports or where she's going to land. That seems, with all due respect, fucking useless. God help her if she gets a cold.
Hey, if you can find me a sketchy spirited exploding some poor man's love bells with raging fire hands, then be my guest, princess. They've all been snatched up by the global corporations and their cock-sucking sponsors. And since our gender is barely a grocery shop at Lidl, then I suggest you shut the hell up.
Go on then, big boy, infuse me with fucks to give.
Jessie climbs out of the river, shaking out her damp book, and she goes to slam it on top of the water. As it hits, we cut to the next scene. A new name strikes upon the scene. Screen. Thomas. The font is shaky, unconfident, and whimsical. Scene 3. Thomas. We hear Harold flick to another slide. The scene changes to some kind of pub. There are two lads sat at a table. One sits on the left of the table, the other on the right, face on. The whole scene is a wide shot, slowly zooming forward.
What can this one do? Fly, but only if he eats quavers.
Sort of.
You've got to be fucking with me. 25k and you're giving me this?
Just watch.
Do the thing.
No.
Do the thing.
Elijah, no.
Do the thing.
You do the thing.
I can't do the thing. You do the thing. Her, over there.
I'm not doing it.
Yeah, you are.
You're not getting the message you owe. It is not happening.
Oh, don't be so... It's a prick. Do the thing.
I can't.
Of course you can. It's just that you won't. Do it.
No, I mean I can't. It requires something.
What?
Thomas writes something down on a beer mat and slides it over to Elijah. Elijah reads it and bursts out laughing. Thomas tries his best to hide his face.
Shut up!
This is the requirement. You've got to be fucking with me, dude. This is golden.
Thomas is silent. He stares at Elijah with a look of shut up, I'm being serious.
Okay. Okay. Your request, sir, is coming right up.
Elijah gets up and leaves. In a second, the song Superstition by Stevie Wonder plays from a jukebox. Thomas's body all of a sudden changes. A knowing smile arises on his face and he stands up, flinging his jumper over his shoulder, slicking his hair back, checking his breath, etc. Then he strides off in the direction of the girl.
Hey, do I know you from somewhere?
Thomas Kitts, 18. Frank Count Zero. Amount of porn watched uncountable. Number of girls his Facebook stalked enough to make even Rolf Harris jealous. Power, instant charmer, ladies man, god of minge.
Jesus, Harold.
What?
Enough with the minge.
Suit yourself. He's an absolute chick magnet. But only when superstition plays.
I hate you. You know that, right?
Yeah, I've been informed. You could come in very handy for social situations. You'll like this next one.
I think this is the only time I've ever dreaded hearing those words.
Throughout their conversation, we could hear Thomas chatting the girl up in the background. The camera stayed focused on the table and Elijah comes back watching them. He shakes his head in amazement and puts his pint down. As soon as it touches the table, the screen goes black and a new name comes up. Mute. This name is weird, sharp on the edges, slightly wonky. Scene 4. Mute. We are now with a girl. She's in her bedroom dancing, with headphones in. Her room is messy, damaged, and looks like the inside of a teenager's bedroom. She is clicking her fingers and dancing as though she's in some sort of performance of Britain's Got Talent show. She is alone. She begins doing weird, impulsive actions. Things like using her bed covers as a cape or snogging her teddy bear. The actions slowly get weirder. She lowers the trench coat she is wearing and starts pissing in a used yogurt pot. She resembles Alison Reynolds from The Breakfast Club a little. At one point, she sticks some pencils up her nose and shouts,
I fucking love cocaine.
A druggie. Oh, nice one, Harold. You've outdone yourself this time.
She's not a druggie. She's powerful.
Mute begins doing more questionable stuff, like wiping earwax on some mouldy toast and pouring candle wax on it, then taking a large bite.
I believe that may have been an understatement, Harold. She's bloody insane.
Mute, 20. Abandoned at birth, grew up mostly alone, a bit loose in the head. Raised in multiple foster homes, but for obvious reasons, they didn't keep her for long. She's duo-spirited. Multiple powers. Firstly, she can create sherbet lemons from nothing.
Great.
But secondly, and more importantly, when she says a certain word or phrase, someone in the room dies. Not all those foster families hated her, if you catch my drift.
That sounds dangerous.
Precisely.
Mute picks up a dart and aims at a dartboard, on which is the face of a platypus. She throws the dart, and as soon as it lands, a new name comes up. Winston. The font is clinical, clean, but still has a price tag hanging off the N on the end. Scene 5. Winston. The camera flashes open. Winston is wiping the lens, leaning very far in. We can see all her facial features. She's nerdy, with glasses, a white shirt still with the tag on, and a slight twitch in her body. She begins to talk to the camera. She looks like a cheap car salesman or someone you might see on an infomercial.
Hi, hello, greetings, earthlings. That's a little joke I like to use. This is Winston. I am Winston, hello. I heard you were looking for some people with superpowers, like the crazy shit. You know, bang, kapow, superpowers. I know what superpowers are, Winston. I can do powers. I have powers. Here's my presentation on what I can do.
She steps aside and shows a screen with a Microsoft PowerPoint on it. It's made with all the cliches, the funky transitions, the word art fonts, the pictures of cats. She flicks through a few slides.
Welcome. My name is...
She flicks to a slide which reads Winston in big letters.
And I have...
Another powers.
And this is...
She shows a slide with a cat picture on it.
My assistant, Jonathan.
Show them what you can do, honey.
Yes, good idea. Okay, see this taxidermy bird? His name is Oliver. I gave him that name. If you were asking... okay, watch.
Winston produces a taxidermy bird from off-screen. She closes her eyes and tightens. There's a pause, and quickly the bird comes to life and flies straight out of shot.
Did you catch it?
I don't know! Watch out, my little sugar plum!
There's a flutter and the camera is knocked out of focus. The bird flies back down and we hear Winston quite literally screaming at the top of her lungs as though she'd been murdered.
I'll get the bug spray! 1 second!
Winston fumbles to the camera and tries to switch it off. As he's racing around the room, Harold speaks.
Winston von Foe, 22, still lives at home. Highly intelligent student. Straight A's, 9th grade piano, violin and trombone. Head girl at a boarding school and leader of chess club. And set up her own geographical politics club focusing on the relationship between man and rocks. Power can turn taxidermy animals into crazy, gnashing, aggressive beasts with intention to kill. Also, the only one to submit a video to us. I had no choice.
Well, she's got potential, I guess.
She has got a few allergies, but we can face that hurdle when it arises.
Of course she has.
Well, Amelia, that's our team. I present to you the ferocious and, yes, rather questionable five.
Winston finally reaches her camera and flicks it off. The words Ferocious Five flick onto the screen. The song, The House of the Rising Sun by the Animals, plays. All five characters are walking down a street towards camera in slow motion, led by Gary. They're all doing something different. Gary is twirling his Nerf gun. Jessie is tucking a book into her handbag. Thomas is just walking, looking shy. Mute is smoking. Winston is stroking Oliver. They continue to walk towards the camera. It is epic. Cut to black. Round of applause!
That was sick.
Lovely stuff, James. Very, very good. Well done. Excellent. So, moving on. We're now going to have a little bit of my writing, which is quite nice.
Dan, I'm really sorry. I'm going to have to cut and run, lovely.
Don't worry.
No, all right. I'm sorry. You didn't need me for the other one, did you?
That's all right. Don't worry. It's all good.
Apologies, everybody.
No worries.
Enjoy the rest of the night. Thank you. Bye bye.
See you next time. So this is Help. And so I think this is just Gemma and Amy.
Yep. We've got radio over
here. Okay, I'll do that. Okay.
That is.
Is, yeah, yeah. Okay. So, again, if you are not in this scene, please mute and hide your camera.
and we'll do this. June, shall I turn that around for you? Yeah. Okay, I'm just going to skip that. Okay. The set is minimal. Perhaps a table and chair on wheels to move smoothly for the quick transitions. The locations are merely a suggestion. A police sergeant is at her desk. A wall clock tells us it's 3 a.m. A woman walks into the station. She looks calm. She approaches the desk.
Is there someone I can talk to? I think I just killed my husband.
Transition to an interrogation room. The woman now sits while the sergeant enters.
So it looks like I'm all you have for now. Detective Shackle will be here shortly. I need your address so we can send a uniform patrol. Would you like to tell me what they're going to find?
I don't know.
You don't?
That is to say, I'm not sure.
You told me.
I think I did.
Kill your husband?
Yes.
But?
I can't be sure.
If you killed him?
I'm pretty sure he's dead.
You are?
But I was sure the last time.
What?
Can we be sure about anything?
You've done this before?
No.
But you just said...
I can't be sure.
Why didn't you call?
Call who?
Us.
Why would I do that?
Why?
We've never met before.
I don't mean me personally.
You don't?
I mean the police. Why didn't you call the police?
The police?
If you weren't sure.
About what?
About what you just told me.
Can we be sure about anything?
But...
Transition to apartment. Woman now stands central, with sergeant off to the side, observing the scene.
I mean, I'm sure I was there.
So you can be sure about that?
I felt I was there, but it didn't feel...
Didn't feel what?
I don't know, I mean... I've not lived there long.
You haven't?
And they all look the same.
The apartments?
They all look the same. Nice place to live. You'd really like it there.
And he was there?
Yes, well...
What?
Hard to say.
Why is this hard to remember? Perhaps you're in shock. Have you taken something?
Transition back to interrogation room.
Look at me.
She does.
What have you taken?
I don't do that.
Drink?
Not today.
Is there anything I need to know about you?
Transition to the woman riding a moped.
6 months ago, I was in the Canaries. Have you ever been? It was my first time, but I... needed to check I wasn't wearing a helmet. No one does.
She suddenly looks worried.
You're suffering brain damage.
Back to the interrogation room.
All of our brains are damaged.
Yes, okay, but when you crashed your motorbike?
More like a Vespa.
All right, well, when you crashed your whatever?
Actually, it was a Honda.
When you crashed it?
I didn't crash it.
But you said?
I didn't say anything.
You said you weren't wearing a helmet.
That doesn't mean I crashed.
So why are you telling me this?
Have you ever been to the Canaries?
Tell me why.
It's a beautiful place.
What happened there?
I saw him.
Your husband?
You can't have been.
Because?
He looked just like.
Who did?
I nearly did crash.
Right.
Because I thought I'd seen.
Seen?
Back in the Canaries.
Did you know the person?
Same clothes, Same haircut. Perhaps he'd run away.
Run from what?
I mean, people do that, right? People run.
Who's running? Who was he?
People change. So many questions. Was he living there? It couldn't be.
Who was it?
He looked so relaxed. It really is a beautiful place.
So I hear.
So you've not been?
No.
He was just visiting, apparently.
Who was?
Lived in the UK.
The man you saw?
Didn't think he'd do that.
Do what?
Come back.
Come back where?
I mean, if you leave somewhere, what reason would you have to come back?
The sergeant pulls woman back into the interrogation room.
Right. Detective Shackle can deal with you and your Honda in the Canaries.
Sergeant makes to leave, then remembers, gets out the notepad.
I just need your address.
Did I not tell you?
You didn't.
But you should know.
Of course I should, but can you remind me, please?
Heritage Avenue, Arctic House, apartment 34.
The sergeant looks at the woman.
Or is it 24? Not lived there long.
Is this some sort of joke?
Definitely 34. Nice place to live.
I think you need to try that again.
You asked for my address.
That is not your address.
It could be.
What did you do?
What did you do?
Sergeant gets the radio.
All units. Heritage Avenue, Arctic House, apartment 34.
Got it, Sarge. Careful on route.
Get there, I'll catch you up.
The sergeant makes to go.
Don't you want to know what they're going to find?
Who are you?
Why didn't you go with him?
What?
To the Canaries.
What?
I would never let him out of my sight. Well, not again, anyway.
Who do you think he is?
Who do you think he is?
The man in that apartment is my husband.
3 years ago, they told me he died. He would never have survived.
What are you talking about?
But people can fake that, can't they?
Fake what?
When I saw him there in that bar 2,000 miles from home, he pretended he didn't know me.
I don't know what you think it is that you know, but you've got the wrong...
Same clothes. Same haircut, even smelled the same.
3 years ago.
He pretended he didn't know me. I mean, my hair's a little different, and I have lost a little weight.
Well, we've been married for 5.
You think you know someone. You give them everything off you, and this is how they...
Yeah, we've been married for 5 years. I've known him nearly 8. It is not the same person.
How can you be sure of that? How can you be sure of anything?
What did you do?
He told me he would love me forever.
Not the same man. And
then he pretended he didn't know me.
What did you do?
I always wanted children.
What did you do?
Maybe that's why he left.
Sergeant grabs the woman and shakes her.
Answer me!
We have the same perfume, you and I.
Transition to apartment 34.
It's a beautiful place. And he looked so peaceful. He still sleeps naked and in pitch black. Some things never change. I took off all my clothes. It'd been so long since I felt his warm body next to mine. Into the bed, and then pushed up against him. Just like before. Like instinct, he rolled over and was quickly inside me. I couldn't believe it. Been so long. Must have been a while for him too, because, well...
More crazy.
Through overlapping dialogue, we transition back to the interrogation room.
People have told me that for a while, when I said he can't be dead. They told me.
Not the same man.
I was crazy when I said we have to keep looking.
You need to get in.
They said I had to stop every doctor,
every police officer, every
you
private...
You need to start answering my questions.
It's not a nice feeling when you know you're right and they're
what
wrong.
What happened next?
I tracked him down.
I mean tonight.
He rolled over and went back to sleep.
What?
Didn't even say goodnight.
You can't expect me.
I could have been anyone.
And then you came here.
That's right. I fucked him and then I came here.
I don't believe you.
You don't have to.
There's no way you could have got into my apartment.
Look at my little bit bag thing.
What?
The little bag. When you took everything from me.
He does.
What am I looking at?
Are you sure there's no way I could have got into your place?
Sergeant suddenly goes pale.
Where did you get those keys?
You'd think he'd be more vigilant being married to a police officer. Did he not even tell you he'd lost them? It seems I'm not the only one he lies to.
He doesn't lie to me.
Are you sure about that? How can we be sure about anything?
I am sure.
Wow.
What?
You are a very trusting person.
What gives you the right?
Did he tell you about me?
What would he... He's not the same man.
I met him in the Canaries 6 months ago.
So you say?
He told me. He had no idea who I was. He told me I was crazy, just like all the other people. I've seen him 9 times since then.
So what?
Your husband has seen a crazy lady 9 times in the last 6 months. And he didn't mention it? I guess not.
So that's it. You've come halfway across town to tell me you broke into my home, fucked my husband and what?
Oh, sorry, forgot to say. I fucked him, came here, and in between, I stabbed him through the heart.
Blackout. Round of applause.
Good story.
Well done, guys. Thank you so much. What a treat. What a
that
treat.
Was great.
Oh, Sarah was in the waiting room. Do you want to just message her and say, cool. Okay. Thanks, everybody. So we're going to end the first half with a little bit of poetry from Stilly. So let's give him the floor. So just mute yourself, turn off your videos, and we'll come back for our break.
Can I have this screen shared, please?
Yes, I'm going to make you the host.
And then, yeah.
Yeah. I can't see you on there. There we go. Just say wait 10 minutes. There you go. So you're now the host there, Stilly.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, so this is a story called a story poem. This is the sort of things I get up to. And this one is called The Quiet Metronome. The clock of the church tower in Emily chimed perfectly 12 times midday, every hour without hitch, perfect time, perfect pitch, ear piercing from 5 miles away. 5 miles beyond that in West Breton, a similar bell tower clapper was striking the same on the clockmaker's name, and that clockmaker's name was Tom Trapper. Tom, raised by his metalsmith father, had forged a first-class reputation as a master clockmaker across every acre, a 1700 sensation, which should have made Tom's life just perfect. But the truth was the sad fact instead, that in all sobriety, Tom's real notoriety came not from the brains in his head. Instead, he had two striking fixtures upstaging his brain in between. For his ears were the size of two Denbighdale pies on a scale that was somewhat obscene. And although for a man whose main interest was listening for Bell's tocsin ticks, his lobes weren't so great in those matters relating to those of the opposite sex. One look at those gigantic lug holes, and all fair maids of discretion would laugh, cry, blaspheme, stare, pass out or scream, and run off in the other direction. The closest Tom got to betrothal was with the squire's short-sighted niece, but her brand new pince-nez worn on her wedding day nearly led to a breach of the peace. And thus, without romantic interests, Tom made a forlorn, sad decision to work night and day both, never plighting his troth, while devoting his time to precision. Tom's prowess with clocks spread as far as the clockmaker's guild in the city, but Tom gave them no heed to their interest and creed, since no member who met him was pretty. Then one day an envoy came knocking on the door of the clockmaker's shed. Sultan Ahmed III had somehow got word that that Tom might be as good as folk said. The Sultan required assistance to mend all the royal palace clocks in Constantinople for 500 opals, or in sheep if he preferred swaps. At first, the poor lad seemed reluctant. All that way seemed a terrible strife. So the price was raised twice, and descriptions enticed Tom to the splendours of palace life. The top-cappy palace was massive, with 2,000 rooms, perhaps more. Kitchens and galleries, treasuries and batteries, a harem and mosques by the score. The word harem made Tom's ears prick up, which caused quite a draft through the room, a breeze which the envoy noticed and enjoyed as he grasped that fresh trades could resume. The envoy explained that the harem housed all the wives and concubines in perfect luxury and, coincidentally, clocks to keep track of their time. So Tom sailed to the Sea of the Marmora on a ship that was truly top-notch. He kept himself busy through storms, wild and drizzly, creating a longitudinal watch. And if his design was successful, it would have been his finest moment. But plans weren't submitted, as on them Tom vomited, which led to a breakthrough postponement. After 6 weeks of voyaging eastwards, Tom arrived at the Sultan's Grand Palace, imposing and prosperous on the banks of the Bosphorus and shrouded in foreboding malice. Now Ahmed III was a short man, despite a tall turban and box, and he gave Tom a glare as he tried to repair the first of the clocks of the court's broken clocks. When Ahmed heard the clock ticking, he started to look well impressed. Appreciation increased with a fantastic feast where Tom sat as his most honoured guest. Tom was told to seek every quarter, roof to cellar and all in between, and fix all those clocks by the next equinox, but not enter the Sultan's harem. Dressed in his new palace kaftan, the clockmaker worked true and steady, and even made one complete with a gong which let people know dinner's ready. And all through his hard work and service, Tom never saw one female form. The harem's guards' might kept each door touch shite as a camel's arse in a sandstorm. When the last clock had been serviced, they all rang with one voice through the grounds. And true to his word, the opals appeared, as well as two much larger mounds. For this was the next pledged installment, if the clockmaker promised wholehearted to the Sultan's new rules and apply all his tools to those clocks in the rooms which were guarded. 400 wives and young consorts were on hand and within easy reach, but sultans have limits, about 30 minutes, to share themselves fairly with each. A better time system was needed to spend moments wisely, not fritter. Those wives were old or liable to scold should make space for the younger and fitter. A small basic tweak to the workings and time could fly by with a skip, especially those wives who the sultan despised and when his back was playing him jip. And likewise, an opposite lever could make the clock slower, not faster, and thus more opportunity for intimate unity and maybe recovery after. The cogs in Tom's turban went whirring. In different directions they reeled, one on horology, one on biology, till further conditions revealed. For no man had stepped in the harem, not even a royal eunuch slave. If Tom made advances or fancied his chances, these actions would lead to his grave. So Tom pulled his turban down tightly to cover his ears and his eyes. What he couldn't see, he thought rationally, he could hardly crave or desire. But the smells, oh, the smells of the harem, the perfumes and fragrance and such, brought out Tom's lustings as he was constructing his new clock design just from touch. Then risking one eye there before him was a beautiful sultry brunette. And before he could check, something ran down his leg, and Tom hoped to God it was sweat. Tom quickly explained his position as he busied himself with his job. She listened intently, and then, oh so gently, began fingering his gears, weights and cogs. The name of the lady was Pasha, with a warm heart, warm eyes and warm smile. Her keen interruptions led Tom to eruptions, and he had to lie down for a while. Tom woke to more perfumes and faces. Pasha's friends had joined to assist. Their shared curiosity and kind generosity, Tom found it so hard to resist. The size of their great admiration, as Tom screwed in the hands on the face, it made their chest swell, which made Tom swell as well, but not naturally in the same place. Their cheers as the clock began ticking, their gyrations as the bell chimed, their rhythmical surges gave Tom physical urges and deep lustful thoughts in his mind. The Sultan, meanwhile, was ecstatic. As each new timepiece was deployed, one push of the button and all of a sudden his time could be better employed. His new concubine from Medina was a tall, dusky maid called Yasmite. Her ample proportions and graceful contortions required lever tugging all night. Tom and his clocks got tongues wagging amongst the harem concubines. They wondered if whether Tom really was clever enough to make brand new designs. Could clocks be designed in their favour to speed up how fast a clock ticks? Well, really, the Sultan did not exult in anything you might call romantic. He only knew one sex position, never asked if he liked it or not. Erogenous zones were complete unknowns, as were foreplay and where's the G-spot. His snores could deafen an elephant. His breath was worse than the sewer. Their lives would be blessed if those minutes compressed from 30 to 5, if not fewer. Now, women have ways of persuasion, as many a man will admit. Lurid skullduggery, crying and cookery, but with Tom, a bare knee would do it. Bravely he fought back advances as more body parts were exposed, but courage diminished after 5 minutes when Tom ran out of options and clothes. One by one he gave in to the torture and showed the clock's buttons attachments. Subsequent rendezvous passed on the news, occasionally in several dispatchments. For in truth, with his ears tightly hidden, Tom really was quite a charmer. Handsome and popular, this clever foreigner might well have found his nirvana. But the Sultan discovered Tom's mischief after several strange nighttime events. After pulling the lever, he couldn't believe the end was up before he'd commenced. Despite his record achievement of 38 bonks in one night, it seemed a bit wrong that his pants were still on and the elastic around them still tight. The Sultan summoned his night watch, who'd only just started their shift. But Tom's room was bare, so they searched everywhere, every inch of the palace they'd sift. The last place they searched was the harem, after all other options eroded. Still, Ahmed insisted that this search consisted of guards who could search rooms blindfolded. But the sounds, oh, the sounds of the harem, the giggles and gaspings and such, betrayed Tom's location to the guards' elation, especially those searching by touch. They bust down the door of the boudoir and found Tom midst a passionate throng. And though he contended clocks were being mended, the tool he was using was wrong. The Sultan demanded beheading and Tom's other bits to be sliced. And so by the next dawn, his body was sawn into a small heap, chopped and diced. The women protested his innocence on seeing the lad's minced up corpse. But the Sultan's tough rule was vengeful and cruel, and even smashed up all the clocks. Tom Tanner's legend was banished from memory by royal mandate. His name never uttered, spoken or muttered by those who safeguarded their fate. But time preserved Tom's legacy, in the royal succession down the years, as his history lived on through the palace children in their memories and the size of their ears. Thank you very much.
Yes, hey. Round of applause.
Brilliant.
Well done.
That was wonderful.
Fantastic.
Good stuff. Lovely, lovely, lovely.
Beautiful.
Great. Well, four very different pieces in the first half, I think we'll all agree. Four fantastic pieces. Well done, everybody. Well done for all our wonderful actors. Let's take 5 minutes, just let everyone let, sort of stretch your leg. Change the video settings again. Where's that? Hide number. Good, okay. So if you're not in this piece, please mute yourself and turn off your camera. And start with this one here. Okay, so. Setting. A sparsely furnished room in a rehab facility. Laverne sits in a side chair at a small table for two. A walker is set to one side of her chair. Liz, her daughter, enters carrying a large bag of takeaway food.
Mum, I bought dinner.
I want to go home.
From Happy Garden. Best Chinese in Wilkes Barre.
Hot and sour soup.
Your fave?
Too spicy and greasy. Can't eat it since I've had my gallbladder taken out.
Okay, I'll have the soup. You can have the Kung Po chicken.
I can't eat the nuts.
Just pick them out. And I got us each an egg roll.
Egg roll? I'm a diabetic. Too many carbs.
Mum, I flew in to spend time with you after your knee replacement. I'm trying to help.
First time you've been home in 2 years.
Don't even think about playing your guilt trip card. I'm not going on that journey.
Oh, yeah. I forgot for a minute. You're an important woman with professional obligations.
The suit is as good as I remember. Mm. San Francisco's Chinatown has got nothing on Wilkes Barre Happy Garden.
The Kung Po's good. Vegetables aren't undercooked like they usually are.
I asked them to give you veggies double time in the stir fry. I remember how you like them. I remember a lot of things, Mum.
How is it?
Delicious.
Didn't they give you any of those sweet and sour sauce packets?
I'm a purist. I don't do the sweet and sour sauce.
You used to.
Time changes people.
I want to go on.
You already said that. Look, it's simple. You can't leave until you finish your rehab. You have to cooperate. Do the exercises.
I don't like that woman.
Who?
Carol Ann, the physical therapist. She comes prancing in here with her good knees, wearing her yoga pants, drags me to the room and expects me to move like a dancing Zumba queen. That woman's a monster in spandex.
You're a secret. She's not crazy about you either.
Carol Ann told you she didn't like me.
She told me you were challenging. And I agreed with her.
You what?
Want a bite of my egg roll?
No! I ate it here. I want to go home.
Then cooperate.
The food's horrible. They're all about the jello. Jello moulds with fruit, jello moulds with mystery vegetables.
You fed me jello all the time when I was a kid with off-brand whipped topping.
Did I?
Yes. A lot. Disgusting. And fruit cocktail out of a can, and you always saved the cherries for yourself.
Laverne finishes her food, pushes the empty carton away.
I have a surprise for you.
Oh, you're not going to tell me you're getting married again? The third time in not a charm.
You've got a new physical therapist.
Oh, joy.
No, oh, Perry. You're going to like him.
She pulls out her cell phone, sends a text.
Him? You expect me to embarrass myself walking all wibbly-wobbly in front of a man?
Mum, I want to get out of here as much as you do.
Yeah, so you can fast-track back to your big shot world.
No, so you can go back into the small orbit of your world that you call a life.
Don't you start on me, Liz.
You always did hate hearing the truth.
I don't want to work with a man, some guy watching an old lady who can't do her exercise right.
Oh, for God's sake, Mum. Nobody expects you to jump up and run around the block after a week after a knee replacement. Quit being so vain about it.
Vane?
A knock interrupts. Perry enters.
Perry! I'm Liz. Thanks for stopping by.
Hi. Laverne?
I am.
I'm your new physical therapist.
What happened to Caroline?
We like to spread the smile around here. So, you're the little vixen giving the PT staff help. That is all about to change. My job is to get you to shape up and ship out of here on the double. Chinese?
My daughter bought it. She always forgets I need to watch my diet.
Eat whatever you want. Then just do the burn.
What?
Exercise! The primo fat-burning calorie meltdown. And starting in the morning, you and I are going high octane.
Thank you.
I can't.
Mum!
Do you know what I used to do?
He moves behind her and massages her shoulders.
Do you know what I used to do before I became a physical therapist?
I wouldn't know.
Drill sergeant, United States Marine Corps, and I don't even hear the words, I can't.
No pain, no gain, Mum.
Half the battle is attitude. I'm all about that toot, about that toot. No whining. I'm all about that toot, no whining. Attitude.
He moves the face out.
Attitude. See you at 7 a.m., Queen Laverne.
He exits singing the refrain.
Oh, the absolute nerve of him.
I like him.
He's one of those bossy types.
I'm all about that toot, no whining. I'm all about that toot, no whining.
Sure, easy words when you're not the cripple.
Oh, cripple, you're a bionic woman with a new power knee.
Laverne paws through her takeaway bag.
Did you get the fortune cookies?
Of course.
She takes the bag and pulls out two cookies.
Pick one.
She hesitates and then chooses.
When you were little, you couldn't wait to read your fortune cookie message. You were so serious about it.
And Dad would make me wait until I finished all of my chow mein.
He sure loved that chow mein.
He pulls her message out of a cookie.
What does it say?
Confucius say better days right around corner.
There you go. And mine says trip for your most successful.
Well, you'll probably land a new account when you get home.
Mum, I am home. I didn't leave my heart in San Francisco. That's just where I live. My heart will always be here.
Oh, I don't just sit there. Give me a tissue. I've got something in my eye.
Liz pulls a Kleenex from her purse and gives it to Laverne. She dabs her eyes, then blows her nose.
Are you bringing dinner tomorrow? I'll need fortification after getting worked over by that drill sergeant.
I can.
He places the dinner trash back in the empty bag.
All of a sudden, I've got a taste for Italian from Zuppa del Giorno.
You won't get an argument out of me.
Liz rises, picks up her purse and the trash bag, moves to her mum and gives her a kiss.
Love you, Mum.
Love you back.
Can I get you anything before I go?
Grab that walker. I might go down to the rec room. Somebody there's always up for a game of cards.
You need help?
Well, that's what this confounded walker's for.
All right. I'll call you after a PT tomorrow and we'll figure out a dinner menu.
He blows a kiss, exits. Laverne stands, gets her balance, notices her fortune cookie message still on the table.
Confucius say better days right around corner. Well, I'm ready. Bring him on.
She exits, aided by her walker, singing.
I'm all about that tune, about that tune. I'm all about that tune, about that tune.
Fade to black, round of applause.
Really good.
Good job. Well done, Vivian. Good stuff. Very prolific as well. Just thousands of players coming in from Vivian, from Columbus, Ohio, I want to say, if I got that right, I just made that up. No, it is Columbus. Yeah, okay. Good stuff. Fantastic. Okay, let's move on into our next piece, which is So Where Are You From? And for this, we are having K Katie, Sam, Caroline, Al, Sue, and Ryan. Katie, Sam, Caroline, Al, Sue, and Ryan. Okay, good. So, let me pull it up for the stage directions. Great stuff. Okay, and just so all of the writers are aware, I am recording this evening's session, so you will be able to get a copy of this for your own records and to be able to kind of analyse in a little bit of depth and whatever you want to do with it, okay? So that is available, so I'll post that up into the Facebook group meeting after the event, so you'll have this as a copy, just so you know. Okay, right. I'm going to turn off my camera as well. You don't need to see me. Okay, here we go. This is, so where are you from? There are five stations on the stage. Upright centre, a kitchen counter and stove. Grandmother is preparing soup. Downright, a park bench. Father is sat reading a paper. Up left centre, a dining table and chairs. Mother is sat playing on her phone, drinking coffee. Down left, two bikes. Ben is sat on his, holding on to the second. Down centre, a bar and stool. Kit is stood behind the bar, cleaning glasses. A man sits opposite on a stool. Each station has subdued lighting, so the characters are always visible and busy until the action focuses on one in particular when the lighting becomes brighter. Scene 1. Lights come up on the bar, where Kit is cleaning and drying glasses. There is a man drinking on his own, looking at her, clearly a bit drunk, and checking her out.
What's your name?
He doesn't look up.
Kit.
Isn't that a guy's name?
Short for Catherine.
So, where are you from?
I'm local.
No, I mean, where do you come from?
Kit pauses for a moment before carrying on.
You mean, where was I born?
Yeah.
Holland.
I've got Dutch mates. You don't look Dutch.
I'm Dutch Indonesian.
That'd explain it.
He circles around his own face with his hand. Kit stops what she's doing and looks at him.
I mean, the colouring, you know, and the good English. Dutch always speak good English, but they're mostly blonde and blue eyes, aren't they?
Kit looks directly at and addresses the audience. The lights dull on the man who silently talks to his pint glass.
I spent about 5 years listening to this kind of shit. Oh, but you sound so English. Oh, you're definitely not from around these parts, are you? I felt like wearing a badge explaining that I've lived here since being a toddler and pointing out that I sound more English than most of my English friends do. But I don't. I mean, what's the point? Dorset's never going to be the diverse epicentre of the universe, is it? But it's not their fault I get so prickly. They're just asking the questions. The problem I have is that most days I'm not even sure where I come from.
She puts down the towel. The lights dim on the bar and the lights come up on her grandmother, who is cooking soup. Kit walks over, picks up a knife and starts peeling some carrots.
This is a good recipe to keep under your belt, Catherine. A good, simple chicken soup. It'll keep your husband happy and fed and your children strong. It's my mother's Jewish recipe, you know.
Kit talks to the audience whilst her grandmother continues to busy herself in the kitchen.
I was always in awe of my grandparents. They were divorced, but stories about how they survived the Holocaust always filled me with a weird combination of wonder and terror. My grandmother and her sister were the only ones out of our entire family to survive due to the light colouring of their skin, and they were able to get false papers. The rest were all sent to the gas chamber.
She's still and silent for a long moment.
My grandfather was also Jewish and part of the resistance. Sounds like a film, right? But honestly, their bravery made me feel proud to be related to them and to be part of the surviving underdogs, to be Jewish. But it turned out I'm not Jewish, that is.
The lights dim on the kitchen, where Kit and her grandmother continue to make soup. The lights come up on the park bench where her father sits. Younger Kit walks on stage and sits beside him.
Are you Jewish, Dad?
Huh?
Are you Jewish?
Yeah, why?
Just never heard you say it before.
Well, only through blood. My My parents were both Jewish, but I'm not religiously Jewish.
Does that mean I'm Jewish?
Nah.
But if you're Jewish, and Omar and Opa are Jewish, and we share the same blood, why am I not Jewish?
Oh, it only passes on from the mother, and your mother's not Jewish.
So what am I?
Eh? What?
Where am I from, Dad?
Well, you're Dutch Indonesian. Your mum's Indonesian.
The lights dim on the park bench and come up on the dining table where her mother is drinking coffee and playing on her phone. Kit leaves the kitchen and walks over to sit across from her mother, who looks at her with curiosity.
You dyed your hair darker?
No, it's my natural colour.
Oh, that's not your natural colour. You're much lighter than that.
Her mother returns to look at her phone.
Mum, look at the photo behind you of me as a kid. It's the same colour.
It's not. That's just the line.
Kit turns and speaks to the audience.
This is an old running argument. I see black, and my mother will swear blind it's white. It should also be noted, my mother dyes her hair a dark blonde. Has done for years.
Kit pauses and looks at her mother for a moment.
Maybe it's because she was the baby girl of the family. There were 11 of them, and she was the only one to be born in Holland. The rest were born in Indonesia. I don't know. I try not to psychoanalyze her. It makes my head hurt. It also hurt when she overheard me telling a friend I was Dutch Indonesian.
You're not Indonesian, you're just Dutch. That's where you were born.
But your whole family is Indonesian.
My parents and grandparents were from all over the place. It's all mixed up. Chinese, Austrian, some Indonesian.
But my cousins are all Indonesian. They all look Indonesian.
Because their mums are Indonesian too. You get your colouring from your dad's side, the Jews.
Kit holds her head in her hands.
So where do I come from?
Her mother looks bemused.
Well, Holland, obviously.
Kit addresses the audience.
There's obvious logic to this, of course. But the problem is, we left when I was little, so I don't feel very Dutch. We don't even speak Dutch at home. But I also don't feel English, so I always sought comfort in the company of my cousin, who is very comfortably Dutch Indonesian.
The lights dim on her mother and brightens on her cousin. Kit walks towards him but stops on the edge of the lighting to watch as younger Kit leaves the park bench and takes the spare bike from him. The lights brighten around, but not on the other stations, as the pair begin to cycle around the stage. Kit walks into the lit space they have left.
I loved visiting Ben's house. My uncle, my mother's brother, always treated me like I belonged there. I was part of the family. These were my people. Even if my skin tone didn't match theirs perfectly, they'd cook nasi goreng, satay, beef rendang, and crispy prawn crackers that still remind me to this day of my childhood visits to their kitchen.
He pauses for a long moment.
It's a powerful feeling to know where you come from and where you belong. I think people underestimate this sometimes. And the answer to, so where do you come from, isn't always a simple or short one.
The cyclists stop up centre and the lights come up a little on all the stations on the stage. Each character stops what they're doing and looks at Kit.
I come from all these people, their pasts, their histories, and all the different lands they've come from and travelled to. In short, I'm Kit. I'm a human. And I come from planet Earth.
Round of applause. Well done. Good stuff, Rachel. Really, really nice. Do you know what? I'm going to have some nasi goreng tomorrow. I'll tell you that. Straight up. Good. Oh, great stuff. Well done. Well done, guys, as well. It was lovely. Okay. Now we're going to have a bit of a monologue. Well, not a bit of a monologue, we're having a monologue, written by David, which is also Kerry, slash, he's a bit of a slashy there, which Caroline's going to give for us, I believe. So everyone who's not Caroline, we'll see you on the other side.
Some people say ghosts don't exist, or that they are simply the result of an overactive imagination. Others look for a scientific explanation, believing that when a traumatic event occurs, then certain stones can act as a recorder, you know, replaying those events repeatedly through receptive people. Of course, there are those who believe that people who die with unfinished business are burdened with the impossible task of seeing it through, and to bring fear to those who see and sense their presence. You always read about ghosts linked to old buildings and ancient grounds. And that is why we never hear of stories linked to modern buildings. For myself, I have no belief one way or another, but I want to tell you about a conversation I had a few years ago. It's a story linked to a high-rise block of flats. I'll leave it to you to judge its merit. Now, we met at a local event, and for the purpose of privacy, I won't say his name. So we started as all small chats do. We spoke a bit about this and a bit about that. I told him that when I first moved into the Midlands because of my job, the council gave me temporary accommodation in a flat that was in a tower block. Then he asked if anything strange had happened to me whilst I was there. What a strange question, I thought. But then he told me his story. I've written it down as best as I recall. I used to live in a tower block called Bolton Court in Tipton. I was in my teens, so it was about late 70s, early 80s, I forget exactly. The lifts were always breaking down, I remember. Yet the building was seen as cutting edge in the 1960s when it was built. Then everyone wanted to live in them. It was a lot different from today. After moving in, we started hearing rumours of people wanting to leave because of happenings in the building. But the council refused. I think they put it down to believing the tenants thought the area too rough and that they just wanted out. Now we lived on the top floor and there were 13 floors in all. Just after a month or so, we started noticing a mysterious clanging sound. It seemed to plague the building. The closer to the top you lived, then the louder it got. In January of the following year, residents got together and complained to the council about this clanging sound that had been going on since the previous September. Now, to give their council their due, they did send engineers, but they found nothing. They couldn't work out what this disruptive noise was. So the council simply put it down to mischievous residents not wanting to live in a block of flats. Council homes were so difficult to get. In fact, as a joke, some councillors dubbed it the Ghost of Bolton, a name that stuck. Some local people, knowing a little history of the area, rumoured that there was an ancient burial ground nearby, and the noises could be caused by restless spirits returning because they didn't like these tall, ugly monstrosities. Of course, many laughed at this, but the council felt that they had to make a public statement saying that there were no known burial grounds, ancient or otherwise, in the land surrounding the block. Something which later by chance, I found out not to be the complete truth. You see, I too later became interested in local history and spent a lot of time reviewing old documents and maps just to see if there'd been a religious site nearby. But what I uncovered was a secret, and one that still holds true for today. You see, the site on which the block of flats was built was chosen because of the natural stone in the ground, which made for a good foundation. And the uncovered secret that was when the block was built, some 300 bodies were discovered to be buried there in what was originally a medieval plague pit dating back from the mid 1300s. The first body was discovered by the construction company in a location that was to be the centre of the foundations of the block. Well, of course, there was an archaeological investigation and the findings recorded, but the report was buried deep in the council archives. And it was decided that the bodies should remain in situ as a mark of respect. And in fact, they remain there to this day. But there's more to this story. It appears that there's been a need for the pit to be reopened a number of times through history. The pit was also used during the plague of the early 1600s. So many deaths, so many bodies. Its last known use was the great cholera epidemic of the early 1830s, where bodies were burned and the ashes placed in communal pits such as this one in Tipton. It's no wonder that this location's history was kept quiet. People can be so superstitious. Anyway, I digress. The clanging noises stopped in the march, just as mysteriously as they'd started in the previous September. Now, you might think that that would be the end of it, but there's more. Later that year, rumours started going around the residence of unexplained visitations. Many included a girl. She was between 8 and 12 years old. Some saw her just wandering around, whilst others tell of her holding their hands and whispering in their ears. They recalled her wearing what was thought to be an ancient style clothing, whatever that meant. These stories grew so strong that paranormal investigators and mediums were called in. It was they who told us that the girl's name was Alice, and that she lived in a house near to where the block of flats stood, but hundreds of years previously. She told them that she had passed away from a disease, but she likes to keep coming back to talk to people. Considering her death, she seemed a happy soul, not the same as other visitations I could mention. I never got to hear about the other visitors, but he continued. I have a memory of hearing footsteps in the reception area many times, and yet there was no one else around when I looked. I have no explanation of that. It got to the point where more and more people refused to move into the block as others moved out or away, and the area slowly got worse. The council finally decided to demolish the flats in 1987, with the final destruction in 1990. It's just an empty piece of land now. Nobody wants to live there, but I dare say it will be used one day when people have forgotten its history. And that's his story. How much of it is true, I can't say. How much he believed them to be ghosts, I cannot tell. All I can say is that he was very sincere in his telling and very affected by it. So I leave you to make your own conclusions based on your own beliefs.
Round of applause. Well done. Good stuff. Well done, Caroline, and well done, Kerry/David. Good stuff. Wow. Just love the kind of eclectic nature of everything that comes together at these evenings. It's just fantastic. Brilliant. But we are now moving on to our final piece, and as ever, it's always Al with a little bit of poetry. Al, I'm going to make you the host because this is going to be a little bit different.
Different, yes. Yeah. Hello, everyone. So I'm going to try something different today. I'm going to try a song.
Hey.
This is could go, you know, one of two ways. I would wonder whether instead of switching off your mics and video, whether you might keep them on, because I've got you in front, so it feels like there's an audience there. If I do this to silence, it'll feel even worse than it does. Rather my embarrassment be reflected back to me in your sort of dead faces rather than just silence. Right. So I'm going to have to do a little bit of preparation here. So give me a second. I'm just going to prepare myself. You know, okay. Right. Good. Because I've got a backing track, you see. So it's very, well, I was going to say it's slick, but let's just see how we go. Okay, this is called Mangoes in My Hair. Can everyone hear me? Mangoes in My Hair.
Yeah.
If you feel like you know the tune and you want to sing along to the chorus, then you're very welcome to. Okay. Here we go. Shall I change my background as well? Just to give it a bit of a pop. Hang on. Let's have Jesus. Okay. Good. It's a bit of an 80s thing, so you can sort of see me moving around. Yeah. Okay, here we go then. Strawberries in my ear. They're affecting every sound. Strawberries in my ear. So you'll have to talk quite loud. Now I don't know if I'm being healthy. Don't know if this diet's wise. But it's something I firmly believe in. As I crush kiwi fruit on my thighs. Push pears up your nose. Of course you have to slice them first. Slice the pears up your nose. Feel that ultra zesty burst. There's a chance that this fad is risky, and I doubt that this health plan sage, but it's got 10 million views on the YouTube, and you can't argue with what is the rage. Mangoes in my hair. Mangoes in my hair. Oh. Okay, here we go. Grapes upon my knee. The crevice round the back. Grapes upon my knee. Energizing my leg crack. And I doubt this is healthy nutrition or a good way to get vitamins. But I'm on quite a strict sort of mission to achieve fitness through some quick wins. Figs between my toes help me reach my five a day. Figs between my toes make me walk a funny way. And I know friends think that I'm potty, that I should just eat fruit like they do. But then who really wants to be normal and do what the normal folk do? Here comes the chorus. Mangoes in my hair. Mangoes in my hair. Oh yeah. I love it. Oh. Gonna be at the end now. Squash fruit everywhere. Mashed in everywhere. And I don't care. On the home straight, mate. On the home straight. Bananas in my hair. Lychees in my hair. Do it too, if you dare.
Oh, gosh.
Melon in my hair. Gooseberries everywhere. Oh yeah. Yeah.
Oh gosh.
Big finish. Mangoes in my hair.
Yeah.
Hey.
Oh, that was a complete joy.
Thank you very much.
Oh, my life is complete.
Thank you. Thank you.
Oh, I think that should be released.
It should.
We're all going to be singing that all night now, aren't we? Yeah.
Fingers in my hair.
Al, can you record a version that I can have as my ringtone?
Yeah. I would love to. I will do one. I will.
Oh, that was class.
Thank you. I wasn't sure whether I would have the nerve to sing it and whether I should do a pre-record, but I think you're such a lovely audience. I've had a gin as well.
Oh, well done.
Al, can I just ask, was the coming in at the wrong time purposeful? Because it was brilliant.
Oh, well, of course. Yes.
Love it.
It reminded me a little bit of Vic and Bob's Big Night Out.
You know, yes.
Taking me back a little bit there.
And I'm a big fan of John Shuttleworth as well. So I was making sure I didn't ease into a bit of John Shuttleworth.
Is he the Pigeons in Flight guy?
Pigeons in Flight. I want to see it.
Yeah. Very good.
Thank you all very much.
That. Thanks again. Al, could you make me the host again, please?
Yes, I should do that by...
the participants?
Go on, hang on.
Yeah. Next to my name, it'll say mute. And it'll say more. If you click on more, you can make me a host.
Okay.
So that is the end of the 8 amazing pieces. We are going to go again on July 14th, which is 4 weeks from today. So if you have a piece you would like to submit, please, you can send that to me direct. If you make the subject line July 14th, New Writers Night, that means I can kind of put them all together. If you want to be considered to be an actor again, just get in contact via the Facebook group. Again, I'll put up two things, one for actors, one for writers. Make it nice and easy for everyone to do that. So please, if you've got any little bits of writing that you're writing at the moment, if you feel inspired to go and write something in the next 4 weeks, go and do that. If you've got a piece of writing that's been in the drawer for 4 years and never been seen before, pull it out, the writing, and share it with us. We're here every month. Next week, the bingo. Hey, no. Please... please share whatever you've got, and please do tell your friends. You know, we've new people again tonight, which is always great, and always great to see so many familiar faces. But keep coming back and keep spreading the word. Can I do this now? Yes. This one here. So we have been watching tonight. We have had our writers. We have had. Oh, I can't do that. Oh, yes, we've had James. Round of applause for James. Woo. Callum. Woo. David. Ow. Woo. Vivian. Me. Rachel. Yay. And Stilly. Woo. And, of course, the actors. Meredith. Gemma. Keep it going. Amy. Jill. Moses. Katie. Ryan. Keely. Al. Dan. Sam, Alina, and Caroline! Fabulous performers, such fabulous writing. What a wonderful night was had by all. See you again in 4 weeks. If anyone wants to get in contact with any of the writers or directors, by the way, I'm sure you can kind of find each other on Facebook, but if you can't do that and you want to send them a message or whatever, please get in contact with me and I can help facilitate that. As much as possible. And just keep the collaborations going, guys. I'm so proud every time I see something up on Facebook where people who have met at these nights have got together and gone on to do something. It's an absolute joy and exactly why we've set up these evenings. So great to see everybody, guys. Much love to you all. And I'll see you in 4 weeks.